Diaries of a Madman. By What Must I Do? Chapter 21. Why I Never Want to Help Rarity Again. And before you ask, I still haven't figured out exactly how the hell it happened. Like, I had no clue, when Rarity was lucid she had no clue, and we were just both completely and totally confused about why we were arrested. But I know that I hadn't actually done anything and as far as I knew, she hadn't done anything either, so I was guessing it was all just a misunderstanding. I was more surprised to learn that Equestria even had prisons, honestly. After a day or so of waiting in that cold, boring cell, we were finally taken to trial. By that time, Rarity had apparently decided she was an invalid or something and was forced to lean on me for support. When we got inside the courtroom, I almost turned around and just went back to my cell. Celestia was there, and she was not looking like she usually did, which was calm, happy, and collected. No, she looked like an avenging angel ready to drop judgment on sinners. We were Sodom and Gomorrah and she was the divine retribution. I put on my best poker face. Do you understand the charges against you? Celestia demanded. No, actually, I said. I was hoping they could be explained. We weren't told a damn thing. You are charged with, she pretended to go down a list of perpetrators to find our case, treason. How do you plead? What? They. Fuck. Rarity almost fainted. I answered for us both, we plead not guilty. There were whispers from the small crowd behind us. When I took a short glance back that way, I saw that only guards were present. Plead your case, then. Well, all good tales start at the beginning, I suppose. As you probably know, I am normally a human. Well, a human with wings. However, because a few certain people can't seem to accept that's how I want to stay, I occasionally find myself in the guise of a Pegasus. My help had just been requested for a sensitive manner, a favor for a friend. The catch, though, was that I had to be a Pegasus again to do it. With much trepidation in my heart, I agreed. An interjection from Celestia, what was the favor? I was asked to work as a model. Not something I'm a fan of. Not something I'll ever do again, if this is any indication of what happens when I try it. Anyway, I agreed to the job, because that's the nice kind of guy I am. They, photographer, I suppose is the best term, was due in a few days, so I had some time to get my human affairs in order. There was little to most of what I had to do, so I finished within a day. Before I was asked to help with this favor, I had been talking to another friend of mine, a mare named Rainbow Dash. She left in quite a bit of a hurry, so when I finished everything I needed to, I checked on her. She was fine, and had just thought of something she needed to do. We talked for a spell over inconsequential things, namely, my past experiences with female humans, what little there were, but Celestia and the court didn't need to know that. I ate my last meal with human hands a day after the request was made, which I suppose is about 9 days ago, now. After that breakfast, I had Twilight Sparkle turn me into a Pegasus. The photographer still had another day until he was due, so I threw a cloak over my blank flank and sauntered through town. I had paraded about like that, in the past, as an agent of the Crown. Which is technically true, if you think about some of what I've done in the past. Anyway, I was found by another friend, called Pinkie Pie, and she wanted to test my body in dancing. Pinkie Pie, another friend named Fluttershy, and I all get together every now and then and dance for fun, but I'm always a human when we do it. So we went off to get Fluttershy to find she wasn't there, and couldn't be found. We did, however, find another friend named Applejack. We managed to coerce her into trying it out, under the guise of a challenge. She and Rainbow Dash are very competitive, and I had just recently invited Rainbow Dash to join us a time or two to see if she liked it. Applejack merely saw it as a chance to get ahead. So we danced. We couldn't do as much as we would have liked, as Applejack is not a flyer, but we were able to do plenty. And then the next day I went to Rarity's shop to prepare for that bloody farce she basically forced me into. She had learned her lesson from the last time she had worked with a professional photographer, and had outfits laid out if needed. Then the photographer arrived, and I have never seen a stranger pony in my life, aside from some of my time in an African port city, looking at some of the nastiest cutie marks I've ever had to see. I won't try to describe her or fake her accent, but she was dressed in some of the strangest clothes. I don't suppose it's my place to judge, but I never really was a fan of any of that fashion show crap. I suppose it could be decent entertainment, but I never got it. To each their own, I suppose. Anyway, the photographer arrived and her agents started setting up. I think at least one of them noticed my blank flank, and the photographer started muttering something about unrivaled potential. I was forced into an outfit and told to act natural. For me, I suppose that would be false hauteur and heroism with an underlying constant search for possible exits. Anyway, I did so. They took pictures and then left without a word. Rather impolite, if you ask me, but whatever. Rarity was nervous. I didn't really care. Sometimes it's nice to do something you have absolutely no connection to one way or another, so you don't care if you succeed or fail. I was told by a somewhat nervous Rarity to stay as a pony for now, and she sent me home. I had been accosted more than a few times on the way there by some ponies calling me, for some reason, Eagle. Knowing what harm it could do to show them my lack of a cutie mark to prove I wasn't this fellow, I just denied their claims and kept walking. So to avoid that, I decided to fly back instead of walk. While in the air, I almost ran into a hurrying Fluttershy. With nothing else planned for the day, I asked if she needed help. Her answer was yes. Apparently one of her animal friends had somehow managed to injure itself, and she didn't know what to expect or what she might need when she got there. So off we went. As it turns out, my help wasn't even needed. It was a small critter that got hurt, small enough for her to easily carry by herself. I didn't know what good I would have been able to do as a pony, but I've found in my years here that any time you don't offer assistance to someone that looks like they need it, you miss out on a possible adventure. When I left for home then, I realized that, hell, I don't have hands anymore. So writing would be impossible, reading would be a pain, I was even more useless to Twilight, and I really just didn't feel like dealing with an increasingly recalcitrant Spike. The town was unexplorable, as everyone kept mistaking me for Eagle. There's only so much you can do in the air, and I had pretty much explored the entire surrounding area by then and knew about every single landmark around it. I was kind of tempted to go out into a big open area and start messing with clouds, but I know they all get where they are because they're put there, and if they're put somewhere they're probably there for a reason. I was also tempted to go flying over the big evil forest conspicuously close to town, but I had helped drag one injured flyer out of there already and I wasn't planning on risking myself like that. I had plenty of times as a human when I was armed, but I didn't want to take the risk as a pony with nothing but hooves to protect me. So it was with absolute boredom that I wandered on down to Applejack's farm to offer any help. I won't pretend that I'm stronger than Big Macintosh, but I did have wings. I figured, if nothing else, I could just fly around and watch. I don't know much about roofing or repairing stuff, but I was able to help fix up some of Applejack's old, decrepit farmhouse and barn back when I was a human. That wasn't the objective of this trip, however, with no hands, operating a hammer and nails would be a bit of a pain. Of course, since it was December, there wasn't much in the way of farming going on. All the harvests had been done and all the land was lying fallow. I was just bored out of my mind and hoping for something to do. Big Macintosh was the first one I ran into, and he didn't know who I was, of course. He hadn't seen me as a pony when I turned on the first time. I had to tell him about the time we got Rainbow Dash drunk to get him to buy that I was me. You ponies are very trusting, I must say. Anyway, he hastily assured me there was nothing going on that they needed help with, but offered the hospitality of the farm anyway. Since I didn't know much about this fellow other than that he has better morals than I decided to chill and talk a bit. He's a pretty cool dude, though somewhat sheltered from being on a farm most of his life. It didn't take long for my presence to be noted by other parties, however, and I was soon ambushed by the three stooges, Apple Bloom, Scootaloo, and Sweetie Belle. Big Macintosh did nothing but laugh as I strove to get away from them. I had been ambushed by them in the past with unpleasant results, so I did my best to get away. It didn't work. When those little demons get a goal in mind, they usually succeed at that goal. And since I didn't want to risk hurting them, I was hesitant to actually strike back. At least it ended in more of a Mexican standoff this time, as I had a nice little trump card they didn't know about, but that isn't really important. I let them think they won and they disentangled themselves from me. In response to their questions, I lied and told them I was here to offer help and if none was available I had plans to help Pinkie Pie with something. I had no such plans, but they would probably want me to do something with them if I didn't have anything else to do, and their ideas of fun often end with me in some manner of either pain or humiliating position. They were content with that, though perhaps a bit saddened, and wandered off upon hearing the resumption of the conversation I was having with Big Mac. It quickly devolved into my accusations of him collaborating with them, and his hasty and obvious lies of denial. He isn't as bad at lying as Fluttershy, but he's not much better. I let him have it, though, since whatever. After that our topic somehow got to women, and I don't want to talk about what was said, since there are some women here today. Still, I somewhat have to wonder why everyone comes to me, a member from a different species, about picking up mares. Anyway, after all the wandering that I had done, it was getting rather close to night. I decided to call it early and head on home. On day 3, I was awoken by a very pleased Rarity. I don't want to talk about what it entailed, but she was happy because apparently she had heard back from that fashion chick. If we could get Fluttershy to come out of her retirement, we were basically assured a job. I was very tempted at that point to tell Rarity to fuck off and to turn me back to a human. I am not a fan of fashion, I don't care for it, and I didn't want to do this in the first place. She made me an offer that I could not refuse. Looking at where I'm at now, I'm thinking I should have refused it. Fluttershy was surprisingly easy to convince. Despite hating her time in modeling, she didn't seem to mind coming back to it, as long as, in her words, it's only temporary, and for helping a friend. The news was sent back to that chick and she wasted no time in stealing all three of us away, though I don't really know why Rarity was invited. We took some pictures in and around town. Since we were both Pegasi, we even took some pictures in the clouds. I saw little appeal in most of what they had us do, but the fashion people looked pleased enough so I stuck with it. That day was killed quickly enough, with all the pictures we had to take. I swear, I think at the end they were out of film and were just faking the noise and flash of the camera. When they were finished, they called it a day and told us to go on home or whatever. Didn't even see an ounce of gold for it, either. Anyway, we went our separate ways and went home. Day 4 didn't involve any annoying fashion people at all. It was, however, one of our dance nights, between Pinkie Pie, Fluttershy, and I. It was different, as a pony, but since I'm awesome I managed well enough. Rainbow Dash came by halfway through it to get involved, and ended up dancing with Pinkie Pie for half the night. It's all in good fun. On day 5, Rarity and I were summoned to the train station. Fluttershy was not invited. I had a bad feeling, but I went anyway. The unrefusable offer was still in play, after all. We spent most of that day traveling to various places, with me modeling with various ponies. I was starting to think Rarity had said something to the head fashion chick about her relationship to me, but I make no accusations. She was there, for whatever reason, and her approval was sought for most of what we did. Day 5 ended with us in a pretty spiffy hotel, and with me more pissed than ever at being in a pony body. It is a hard feeling to describe, and if you've never had your body changed, you probably can't understand. I kept doing things that to a human would be second nature, but to a pony would be either impossible or painful. And having to be on four legs was annoying as piss. And I could feel my fingers, in a way, even though I knew they weren't there. I kept trying to pick things up or touch things, only to feel them slide away against my hard hooves. But I was promised that this would only last a few more days, and then I could disappear back as a human again. Day 6 was pretty much the same as day 5, only I spent a lot more time among the wealthy and affluent. The day ended with us chilling in a mansion, where the very familiar mistress of the house tried to seduce me, I think, and when she failed, I'm pretty sure she put something in my water that I casually swapped with the fashion chick when no one was looking. Yet, when Fleur stopped by my room that night, she was very surprised to see me awake. I pointed her to photo finish's room. Day 7 was pretty similar to the last two, with the exception of me and Rarity getting arrested on the third stop with no explanation. The last day was spent in a rather cold cell, having to cuddle next to Rarity to keep warm. It was hell. Rarity was given time to give her spiel after I told my position. It was, for the most part, an overly dramatic and tear-filled version of mine. She didn't have the dance night, the attempted seduction part, or any of the reluctance. If I had thought we actually had a chance of being convicted, I would have poked her and told her to stop acting, but I was pretty sure we'd be cleared. When Rarity finished her testimony, there was relative silence in the courtroom. I wouldn't be surprised to turn around to see that most of the ponies attending had fallen asleep. Celestia picked up her gavel with magic, solemnly intoned guilty, and banged it down. The only thing in my mind was, well, shit. Then we were hustled back into our cell. So, I asked Rarity in one of her moments of lucidity, what's the penalty for treason? Life or death, depending on the severity of the treason. What did we even do? No clue. Think you can use your magic to send a message? I've tried. This place is walled off against magic. I can cast spells in here, but I can't send anything out. So much for getting help from Luna. That also meant no help from the Naga, Twilight, any of the cat people that could get here in time to do anything, or any of the surviving ponies that fled Egypt. After making us cool our heels or hooves, in this case for a day, Celestia came by the cell to deliver our sentence. I didn't know at the time why she did it there instead of in the court, but at the time I also didn't care. When she walked in, I greeted her, "Howdy, Big C. I don't suppose you're here to change your mind." "That's a rather irreverent way to greet some pony who holds your fate," she answered, glaring down at me. "Well," I answered, "you already know that if you sentence me to life in prison, I'll kill myself. If you sentence me to exile as a pony, I'll kill myself. If you sentence me to death, then I might kill myself just to spite you. And if I make sure you have no ways of killing yourself in your cell. You should never underestimate the human mind when it comes to planning violence. I will find a way to die, if it comes to that. That's a shame. I came here to sentence you to life." Rarity started whimpering and crying. I replied, "You monster. You finished?" Celestia asked. "Yeah, I'm good." "What kind of life?" "Whatever kind of life you'll make for yourselves. You're free to go. I don't even know why you were arrested. Probably some archaic law invoked by that noble woman you spurned. I only pronounced you guilty to see what would happen. I've never been able to do that before." "Cool, when can we leave?" Rarity, however, was not at all cool with it. "You? What? What kind of immortal princess are you?" "The kind that gets bored a lot," I answered for her. "Day. Let's go, Rarity. And no more fashion stuff for me." It wasn't as simple as that, though. Rarity was in full-blown psycho mode. Celestia ended up silencing her with magic and I led her away. It was kind of funny. But I knew it would be a bad idea to let her know Celestia was like that. When we got them apart, I said to Celestia, we should probably find a way to make her forget this trial and arrest happened. And we should also probably find me some clothes and turn me human again, but that can wait until I get home, I guess. I agree about making her forget. Some ponies just can't handle having a leader that gets bored sometimes. One day I'll have to tell you about the time I spent a year disguised as a chair, just to see what would happen when I disappeared for so long. Oh man, the wrong sister fell in love with me. Celestia, you're awesome. Celestia used her magic to put a still fuming Rarity to sleep, and made her forget the past few days. Then she put us on the train and sent us back to Ponyville. I suppose it was an interesting way to spend a week and a half. When we got back, I poked Rarity until she woke up, managed to convince her she was too stressed if she didn't remember those days, told her not to worry about it, walked her back to her home, and then got myself turned back into a human. When asked by Twilight how it was, I just said, never again. To both being a pony and the fashion industry, I was hoping, I was tired of both, and this was the longest time I had spent in that form yet. If that fashion chick came back around here trying to find my pony body, I had plans to hole up on a cloud with my crossbow and dare her to come and get me. I was tempted to brag to Spike about my temporary closeness with Rarity, but she didn't remember and he was being dickish enough as it was. Seriously, I needed to go into the forest soon to kill something for us both. It was only my previous experience trying to hunt in there that stopped me. Well, that and the risk of killing one of Fluttershy's friends. Not much really happened from that point until during winter wrap-up, and I only include this because I feel it is sadly necessary. Yes, reader, I write about the time I finally got caught in the magic of the song. Now, I had seen several of these songs happen in the past. The first year's winter wrap-up, on the boats to and from Africa, a bunch of Pinkie Pie's songs that she seems to make up and practice all the time, and when we got all the ponies in Ponyville trashed, though I don't remember that one either. Anyway, I was in my second winter wrap-up, on my third year in Ponyland, when I got caught in the damn singing magic. I was the first one, you see, so I didn't have time to build up any resistance to it. Basically, as soon as I stepped outside Twilight's house, I was punched in the face by the song magic. There's not any other way I could really describe it. I know my voice sounded considerably better than it was supposed to, and it fit perfectly with what everyone else was singing, but I was definitely the first one to start it. Dude, I don't even want to talk about what it was we sang about. I will say, though, that it was a lot darker than the usual pony songs, but not necessarily in a bad way. It gave hints at the Luna situation, the Cot situation, and my time as Egil, but no specifics. I have no idea how the ponies managed to keep up or how any of it fit together, but I guess that's magic for you. It was also fitting for winter, though maybe not for a day that was supposed to be happy. It did end on a very pleasant note, however, with Fluttershy popping in about a better tomorrow and a coming spring. I find myself hoping as I write this that the message imparted there would be true, and that the going would get easier. But I never did believe in storybook endings. If nothing else, I was hoping I wouldn't run into any more psycho women. Oh, and a side note, in case anyone reading this is wondering, whenever you get caught up in the song magic, none of the ponies will ever hold anything you sing about against you. It is mostly uncontrollable and it's impossible to determine who might be the next victim, so there's the unofficial rule that anything sung about will never be asked about or brought up. Not like anyone is reading this, though. The rest of winter wrap-up was pretty chill. I helped Fluttershy again, since that was pretty much all I knew. The animals were getting used to me anyway. Still, fuck singing. Oh, and Pinkie Pie did throw me a party for my birthday. Sadly, for a 21st birthday, there was very little drinking, and none of what was done was alcoholic. We used almost all of the booze for the big returning home party, and the rest was saved up in case I needed it for anything that wasn't drinking related. It was one of her typical parties, with hooting and hollering and all that carrying on. I pretended to enjoy it to humor her, but I really don't much care for stuff like that. Never did.